cool that, like, we're not genius enough here to plan this thing out. But how cool that on the night before Thanksgiving, we're going through John 3:16. So anyway, I was kind of excited about that. But anyway, just thinking about Thanksgiving, I know everybody thinks about it, and I just want to help you kind of think through Thanksgiving. So if you'd check out the screens and watch this video.
And now, a Thanksgiving moment.
You know, this is the time of year when we realize what it is we have to be thankful for. Of course, I'm talking about Thanksgiving. I know it. Hang on a second. This is called suede, buddy, so you need to be careful with that lollipop. It's time to be with your kids and your nieces and nephews, and don't touch them. That's just going to egg them on. It's time when I remember all the warmth and love of conversations and, Guys, hey, guys, seriously.
Why don't you come help?
Don't even. But I know that I remember growing up, you know what, this is not going to work. Haley, I'm sorry, my back is killing me. This kid's about to break my knee off. This one is as ripe as it gets. We need a lot of wipes for that one. Well, that's right, and I remember the turkey and dressing, and you bet there was some cranberry sauce if Uncle Teddy had anything to do with it. And Uncle Floyd, I tell you what, Haley, you've got to get her out of here because my headache is about to explode here.
Hey, seriously, Daryl, how about helping out this year?
Hey, I'll tell you what, why don't you go outside and wait for me? All right. And I remember sitting around and laughing as a family, and sweetie, I have got to have some room here to do this. I know, you know what, this is like a practical joke. This is terrible. Okay, I'm about to freak out here.
Daryl, should we put you at the kids' table since you're helping about as much as they are, or?
Hold on.
Don't point. Do not point at me.
So my hope is that you have a very blessed time and a relaxing Thanksgiving.
Some days it just feels like that, man. Let's pray. Father, we're going to come before you right now, God. And Lord, as we come before you, we're just going to, Father, as we continue on looking at your word, God, as we continue on looking at the letter that John wrote. God, that John's whole purpose of writing this letter was that you would become real in people's lives, and that there'd be a revelation of who you are and what you've done, and that sometimes, God, just like in the video, we have this great exterior, we have this great outward look, God, but what's going on inside the heart and what's going on inside our lives is completely different. And Father, that you have a way of revealing yourself to us in such a way that doesn't reveal necessarily all of our brokenness, God, but just it reveals all of our need for you. And so, God, that tonight would be a night that as you reveal yourself to us, God, that we would just stop and give thanks and recognize. And so, Lord, we're going to ask your presence to be here. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. What we started with and kind of how I ended up here on the floor, because some of you guys who weren't here last week, like this whole row right here, not the whole row, I noticed, because these guys have been working in Alpha. Alpha just ended, and Alpha's a program that we, so this is like, oh, you pick people out that don't show up. That was probably a little shocking. No, these guys work with Alpha. And Alpha's a program that we run at the church that is a program that people who that kind of have questions about God, it's this program that they can go to, and they don't, it's not a connection, like necessarily like they're connected to church at all, and so they can come, and they just ask questions, and it's this really super cool program, and so I love the fact to see you guys, all right, never mind, yeah, so anyway, that what we're talking about is that there's this real connection. One of the things that happened with John, the book of John is really written for this one purpose, and it is to connect people who feel distance from God. And that the whole goal is that as Jesus is kind of connecting, that the whole idea is that his connection into our lives becomes this revelation. It becomes this place where you look up and you go, wow, God's real. God's alive. And John 3:16 is one of the most memorized scriptures in the Bible. It is the verse that when you went to Sunday school and they taught you and they said, hey, listen, you need to know this scripture, and everybody learns John 3:16. And what's interesting about John 3:16 is this. They take John 3:16 and they tie it and they connect it to Jesus' death on the cross. And we all, when we think of John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son. That most of us have this idea that this giving is the fact that Jesus gave his life on the cross. And it is that, it becomes that, but that's not the purpose of John 3:16. The purpose of John 3:16 actually comes out of John 3:1. And what happens is this, is that John 3 is really this idea that John is trying to convey to people that there was this man named Nicodemus, and he was on a search for God. Have you ever been on a search for God? Right? Okay. Like you were on this search for God. And what? Maybe you're on it now. Maybe you've been on it. Maybe you're not so much on it right now, but you're kind of playing around with this idea. But John 3 is really this purpose about this guy who he really thought he understood God. He was a Pharisee. And Pharisees aren't just guys. In this Jewish culture, a Pharisee's not just a guy. He's a religious guy. And it's so interesting that so many people can actually grow up in the church, can actually be up to their eyeballs in religion, right? And totally miss God. And so John 3 is about this guy that begins to recognize things that God is doing. And when I say God, he's recognizing them in Jesus, that he sees Jesus do things that other people don't do. He sees him healing people. He was probably there. When Jesus turned the water into wine, he was probably there at that banquet. And if he wasn't there at that banquet, then probably the chances are that people that he knew were there, and they came back and told him that he had a connection to that. And so he began to hear stories, and he began to see things, and he began to make this connection that this guy was more than just a guy. And so John 3 is about this man who's really trying to do nothing else than figure out God. And I think that that happens for everybody. And when I say everybody, I mean everybody. I think that when I come across people, you find people that whether they're in church or whether they're not in church, it's interesting that you will have spiritual conversations with everybody, right? How many of you guys have friends that are non-spiritual people? They would consider themselves a non-spiritual person. Or maybe they would consider themselves a non-church person. You guys have those friends. How many of you have those friends? All right. How many of you have had spiritual conversations with those types of people? Everybody. Because everybody has questions about God. Everybody seeks kind of a spiritual journey. And so you have this guy that he's a Pharisee. He's a religious guy. But he's not just a religious guy. I mean, when you think of a Pharisee, when you think of like a religious guy, to be a Pharisee, you were a person who studied religious law. And so he wasn't just studying religious law. Actually, to be a Pharisee, you had to be able to know and quote the entire Old Testament. Like, that's pretty good, right? Now, his study was in religious law, meaning that he understood all of the laws that it took to maintain righteousness. The book of Leviticus. Have you ever read the book of Leviticus? You have to be amazingly spiritual just to read it. And just to read it, you have to be like, yeah, I love the Bible. As a matter of fact, every day what I do, I read Leviticus. And then everybody stands back and goes, whoa. The angels sing. Whoa. Okay, the angels sing sounds better than that. If you think that that's angels singing, you probably think I have rhythm. And sing and clap. I don't. I have none. There's none there. But the angels sing when you're studying Leviticus because you're holy. Like, you have a great shiny exterior. And so this guy was that guy. And as he's that guy, he begins to recognize that there's a disconnect between what he knows about God and what God's doing. Have you ever recognized that? I mean, I think all of us come to this place that God's doing something amazing. And you go, wait a second, I thought I had God figured out. And only to come up and go, but this does not look like what I thought God should look like. Like these Pharisees, when they're looking for God, this is interesting. When they're looking for God, what they're really, really looking for is for God to come into their life the way they think he should. Like that's the thing with our relationship with God. That's one of the issues that we have. When God doesn't respond the way we want him to, then we go, oh, I don't really know if this was a God moment or not. And I don't know if this was a God moment. Because the Pharisees were looking for this glorious guy to come up and come on and be king. He should be the king. He should be the best of the best. He should be the brightest of the brightest. He should be the Jew of all Jews. And that when they discover this guy, here's what they're going to do. They're going to take him and they're going to put him up on a pedestal. And everybody's going to bow down to him. And they're going to say, now that's my king. And what they get is this guy who's born in a manger. Okay, we don't understand manger, do we? But we understand barn, right? We understand horse manure, right? We understand hay. We understand that he was came in and that his mom and dad weren't even married yet. Like, you get that? This is not the best of the best. This is not a rich guy. This is not the Pharisee of all Pharisees who would stand up and make even Nicodemus look stupid. Although, if you read John 3, he gets that one done. And so then he comes back, and he's recognizing that God's doing something. And the reason I'm giving you all this background is this. The book of John was written so that people would be in the understanding of that the revelation of God is Jesus. Like everything that you're looking for, not what do you want it to be, but everything that God is revealing. The book of John is about revelation. That John writes about revelation. He writes the book of Revelation. But even in John, the book of John, not the book of Revelation, but the book of John, he's trying to convey this idea that God is revealing himself to us. Are you understanding? And so this story is a story about a man who thought he understood God, and he didn't. And so Jesus is revealing himself. So if you have your Bibles, flip over to John chapter 3. I'm going to pick up where I left off last week. I'm going to read down through verses 9, and I'm going to end in verse 21, but I'm really only going to teach out of verses 16, 17, and 18. And I think I've got 9 in my notes, but I think I'm only at 16. Is that right? Okay. Nicodemus said to him, how can these things be? Jesus answered him, are you the teacher of Israel? So Jesus has just explained to him about spirit and flesh and how flesh begets flesh. Like I'm a product of my mom and dad because they're flesh begetting flesh. And he's saying that flesh begets flesh and the spirit begets the spirit. So you cannot pass on spiritual things. You can pass on spiritual knowledge, but you can't pass on spiritual God. God passes on God. Flesh begets flesh. And Nicodemus is saying, I don't get it. Like, this is a guy who, he doesn't just know about the Bible, he knows the Bible. We've got some guys around here, we have a Bible quizzing group. And I have a guy in our church that he's 19 years old, and he's been in Bible quizzing since he was probably 6 or 7. He can quote all of Romans, he can quote all of John. He has about 3 more books of the Bible that if you just ask him and say, okay, John 9, 11 through 12, boom, he can do it. Like, that's a pretty good talent. That's a good party trick. Now, probably him and the party probably don't mix, but kind of a good party trick. Nicodemus was that guy. And Jesus was saying, wait, you're not getting it. So he says, you're the teacher of Israel, and yet you don't understand these things? He says, truly, truly, I say to you, we speak of what we know and we bear witness to what we have seen, but you do not receive our testimony. If I told you earthly things and you do not believe, how can you believe if I tell you heavenly things? No one has ascended into heaven except he is descended from heaven, the Son of Man. And if Moses was lifted up and the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him will have eternal life. And he's basically just saying this. The reason that we say that Jesus is the way and Jesus is the only way is because the only way that you can know how to get to heaven is to have come from heaven, right? Like what's interesting is people want to say, no, Jesus is a way. And there's many ways to get to heaven, right? There's many ways to get to heaven. Jesus is a way. And we're going to talk about this next week. We're going to talk about condemnation. And the problem with that statement is this, is that Jesus is not saying that he's the way because he's arrogant and he thinks he's all that, although Jesus is all that, right? Jesus is all that. I mean, like when you compare your life to his life, like even, let's say, if he wasn't God, have you ever healed anybody? Have you ever walked on water? Right? I mean, like, if you just walked on water just a little bit, everybody would go, dude, you're all that. But you haven't. And so Jesus is saying, I'm the way, not because I'm arrogant. I'm the way because I came from heaven. Therefore, I'm the only one who can tell you how to get back to heaven. And see, here's arrogance. If I say, hey, Scott, dude, you're going to come to my house. We're going to eat dinner. What do you want? I'm going to cook you a 21-ounce steak. You in on that, dude? That's good, right? I'll like baked potatoes, the whole nine yards. At my house, there's a party, and you're going to come. You're like, dude, I'm in. And then I say, okay, here's how you get to my house. And he's like, no, dude, I know how to get to your house. And I say, have you ever been? No, I've never been. But I'm sure you don't know how to get to your own house. So just let me figure it out myself. That's arrogance. That's the sign of arrogance. The sign of arrogance is when you look at somebody who knows what they're talking about and you tell them they don't. And God is saying, I'm the way, not because I'm all that, which he's all that. He's saying, I'm the way because I came from the way, because I'm God. And the only way that you can get there is to come through me because I'm the only way because I know where I'm going. Does that make sense? So then he says this, that whoever believes in him would have eternal life. So he says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved. This is the part that I'm talking about that isn't the arrogance. God didn't send his son into the world in order to condemn the world. Like Jesus' job isn't to go around and say, oh, not working. You're not doing good. Oh, not doing okay. Like, you're in, you're out. You're in, you're out. You're in, you're out. That's not what he's doing. That's not his job. So he says this, where did I leave off? Verse 18. So whoever believes in me, whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe in him is already condemned because he has not believed in the name of the Holy Son of God. And this is judgment. The light has come into the world and people love the darkness rather than the light because their works were evil. That just means this. People like hanging out with people they like hanging out with. Evil people hang out with evil people. People that are partying, drinking, doing the things they're not supposed to be doing in the sense of that things that don't honor God. Right? You guys all have had those days, right? You've all had days where you didn't honor God. Where like, the things that you were doing, you weren't supposed to be doing. Okay, he's just saying that when you're doing things you're not supposed to be doing, none of us hang out with people that are doing right when we want to do wrong. I can remember a time when I was in junior high and me and my friends were breaking into a place. Yes, we were doing that. You're like, okay, now I'm listening. So we're breaking into this place. And as we're breaking into this place, I've got three friends inside. I'm halfway in. And my friend who's with us stands back and says, Paul, don't do it. I'm like, what? Don't do it. He's like, yeah, don't do it. I'm like, no, dude, come on, let's go. He says, no, don't do it. I said, no, come on, let's go. And he looks at me and he says these words. He says, Would Jesus do this? All right, at that moment, would Jesus do this is really not the words you want to hear. Because that makes you feel really, really bad. Breaking in with friends doesn't make you feel bad, but just knowing if Jesus would do it makes you feel bad. Point of the story. I knew what he was talking about, so I felt guilty. But during this period of my time, I wanted to do these kind of things. So I stopped hanging around him. Why? Because he didn't do these things. And he's basically just saying, people that have an evil heart to do evil things, they hang out with evil people because that's how you get into trouble. You hang around with troublemakers. And this is the judgment. The light has come into the world, and the people love the darkness rather than the light because their works were evil. For everyone who does wicked things hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his works should be exposed. But whoever does what is true comes to the light, so that it may be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in God. And basically, he's just saying this, that when you come to Christ, the reason you come to God is that you take your stuff. He's telling Nicodemus, the reason that you come to God, the reason that you recognize God, is because you take your stuff. And you keep hanging out with the evil guys, doing the evil things, doing the things that aren't God-honoring. And that God comes and he gets a hold of your heart and he says, what are you doing? Don't do that. This is how it works. That's just how it works. That's how it works for me. It's how it works for everybody I know. That God gets a hold of your life and he says, what are you doing? Don't do that. He doesn't say, oh my gosh, you are a screw-up. Like, I've met a lot of screw-ups, but I've not met a screw-up as big as you. Like, you've got this stuff going on in your life, and it's like, why are you doing this stuff? Like, you have all this evil stuff, and like, the reason you have evil stuff isn't just because you have an evil heart. It's because you're stupid. That's what the Bible wants. That's what people want to tell us. But that's not what God's doing. You know what God does with my life? He just kind of comes around and he says, hey, Paul, don't do that. And I say, I know, I shouldn't do that. And I say, but God, I kind of like doing that. He says, no, don't do that. It ruins our relationship. That's all that's going on. Is that when God comes into your life, he's conveying, he's coming to you and he's saying, man, this is the kind of stuff that ruins your life. Don't do that. And from an evil heart, we have to come back and we go, okay, God, well, then what's going on? So here's the very first thing I want you to write down. This passage that Jesus is going through with Nicodemus is this. He's just simply saying, Jesus came to reveal God. The purpose for Jesus coming is to reveal God. He's saying that there was this guy that came to Jesus. His name was Nicodemus. He was a really smart man. He thought he understood all that there was to understand when it came to the Old Testament. That when it came to the Torah, when it came to the Bible, he thought he had it down. And yet, when he compared his life to what Jesus was doing, the two didn't match up. And so he began to ask questions. And that any time that you and I will ask questions of God, God will always reveal himself. And Jesus came for one reason. He came to reveal God. You see, and here's something. If you don't get anything else, you got to get this. One of the most important principles that Jesus is talking about is he's talking about this principle that everything starts with God. That's how life works. Everything starts with God, and God is knowable. You see, I think that as Christians, we come up with this idea that I'm never really going to truly know God. I can know his word, and maybe I'll never have this relationship with God, like the one that I really want to have. But so what I'll do is I'll just do what the Bible says. I don't know how to really know God, but I'll just do what the Bible says. And Jesus is saying, no, that's not the purpose. Like, you can know this inside and out, and you still may not know God. The purpose in knowing and connecting with Jesus from Nicodemus' standpoint is Jesus is trying to kick back and saying, Nicodemus, like, I'm really glad you know this, but do you know God? Do you know how much God loves you? He could quote the Bible. He was the Pharisee of all Pharisees. He knew about God, but he didn't know God. And way too many people know about God. And way too many people in the church know about God. I love this. That he's talking about everybody knows about knowing God. He says this. We always pass by this. John 3:16. For God. The whole idea was God. For God. Hey, Nicodemus. This isn't, there's this idea that's conveyed that Jesus came to reveal God because God wouldn't reveal himself. That as Christians, we kind of come up with this idea that Jesus is this good guy and God's kind of hard to get to know. And Jesus is saying, Nicodemus, the whole thing starts with God. For God. For God was thinking about you. For God so loved the world. That when you're looking for God, don't forget to start with God. You see, sometimes what happens in my life, this is what I do. When my life is going crazy, I stop and I go, okay, well, here's what I need to eliminate. I need to eliminate this. I need to eliminate this. Or sometimes when I'm looking for a job, I think that, okay, now here's what I need to do. What I need to do is I need to find 10 jobs today. I need to look for 10 jobs today. Or maybe when you're in a relationship and you're looking for the right guy, like girls don't ever do that, right? Oh, come on. They walk through and you're like, no. No. Maybe. No. No. Oh, you're in. You're in. But, right, we do this in the relationship thing. We're looking for what we think we need, we think we want. And Jesus is saying, no, for God. That our lives are supposed to start with God. Now, I'm not the guy that wakes up in the morning and spends the first hour on my knees in devotion. Some guys do it that way. For me, my day starts with God. And my day starts with just simple prayer. And I kind of wake up and I kind of get my day going. And there's just this process of me and my relationship with God. For God. When you're looking, start your day with God. Start with God. That there should always be this place in our life that as we're looking, that we start with God. And there should be things that happen in our life and in our day that cause us to recognize God. Did you know that? I have some friends, John and Lisa, they're in my small group. And you know what made them recognize God? Evil. I mean, that sounds kind of crazy. What made them recognize God? What made them go, you know what? We have got to get connected to God. September 9/11. That when that thing happened, this was some friends of mine, and they were not connected to church. There was no church thing going on in their life. And there wasn't really people in their life saying, hey, listen, you need to come to church. You need to come to church. That was happening a little bit. But all of a sudden, when they watched the TV screens and they went, oh, Lisa began to look for a place to go that night. All she wanted to do was connect with God. And she brought her husband. And they brought their kids. And on that night, we had a worship service. And they showed up. And she gave her life to Christ. He gave his life to Christ. They brought down all their kids. Their family gave their life to Christ. You see, here's what was going on. She was recognizing, just like Nicodemus, she was recognizing things in her life. And because she was recognizing things in her life, she began to go, there's God. I got God. And it wasn't making the connection all the way, but then all of a sudden something big happens, and all of a sudden she goes, oh, for God. You see, here's what I think is really awesome. That Jesus came to reveal God, but Jesus came to reveal God's love for the world. I love this portion in John 3:16. He says, for God. And this has been with me now for 3 weeks. If I've just been passing by this and reading this passage. For God so loved the world. I think sometimes we miss it. Sometimes we're reading, for God loved the world. Right? For God loved the world. And John's saying, for God so loved the world. He didn't just love the world. This isn't just like, hey, the world's nice, the world's cool. For God so loved the world. And so this week I was listening to some worship stuff, and there's a new movie out called Amazing Grace, and there's a song that Chris Tomlin, after he watched the movie, he went back and he rewrote Amazing Grace and penned it. And so this week, as I go and buy this, I just went, you know what? Rachel, would you remind us about that, for God so loved the world. So I just want to pause for just a second. I don't want you to stand or anything. This isn't worship song. This is a time to concentrate on for God so loved the world. That where are you at? Where's your connection point at with God? When you come to that place and for God so loved the world, you go, for God so loved the world. That's amazing to me. You know why that's amazing to me? Because there are days when I love the world. There are days when, man, I'm out and I'm like, man, that's beautiful. I understand why God loves the creation of the world. Like, when you look at, we watch this new show called Planet Earth. Have you guys watched that on Discovery Channel? And there's this one picture that we're watching this week, and it is these white this flock of white geese. And they're going up to the Arctic. And as they're going up to the Arctic, it's panning in on them, and there's this little dot, and there's these white geese, and going, that's beautiful. And then it pans back, and it pans back, and they are as tight as they can be. It's beautiful, and it pans back on a 5-mile radius. And as far as you can see, there's geese. And you're like, wow, that's amazing. That's beautiful. And so there's these things that you go, wow. That's beautiful, for God so loved the world. And so I can get it. When I'm watching Planet Earth, I can get this whole idea in my head about God really having this creation that's beautiful and him going, dude, I created that. That's beautiful. That's good. But you know what? There are days where I'm with some friends this weekend and they just got back from India. And while they were in India, they came across this information about the human trafficking that happens in India, which led them to further study about human trafficking across the world. And there's like 2.5 million children in India who are under the age of 10 that are captured, that are taken from their homes, that are put in cages and used as sex slaves. That they're literally used as sex slaves. As a matter of fact, one of their friends was in a restaurant, and as he was looking at the menu, he was checking out the menu, and he looked on the back, and on the back of the menu was the dessert section of the menu. It was 10-year-old children that you could purchase for sex. And you see, there's this thing that, man, I totally get this. For God so loved the world. And stick with me for a second. For God so loved the world. And you take, and there's these beautiful portions of the world. And you go, I get it. And then there's these other sections of the world that I just go, I don't get it. Right? Do you get that? And yet John 3:16 says, for God didn't just love the world. He didn't like the world. He didn't just, like, that's okay. It says, for God so, he so loved the world. He's so in love. He's so in love the world that he gave his only son, that he looked out and he saw all the good and he saw all the bad and he went, it's worth it. I love it. It's worth it. And here you got to get this, because there's days when I understand why God loves me. There's days when I wake up and like, smart, good-looking people like me. Why? What's not to love? He says. He looks down and he's like, yeah, God, I get why you love me. Sure, I was worth the sacrifice. But most days, I'm going, God, I don't get it. Like, you so love me? Like you so love me now? I mean, I understand when you love me here. Here, look, God, I'm shiny. But what about the days when I'm not shiny? What about the days that I have more often than I don't? But more often than not, they're not shiny days. And Paul, and God's going, yeah, I so love you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. You see, he's telling Nicodemus. He's saying, Nicodemus, you think you know. You think it's found in doing. It's not found in doing. As a matter of fact, it has nothing to do with you. It has everything to do with God. That we get to stand in God's amazing grace. Not because of anything we've ever done. Not because of anything we ever will do. That on my best of days, it's still only by God's grace that I get to stand. That it's God. John 15:13 says, Greater love has no one than this, that he would lay down his life for his friend. You see, here's why I'm in love with God. Because the undeniable truth is this, is that true action always follows true love. That God's action, God's idea, God's plan was Jesus. It wasn't your plan. It wasn't my plan. It wasn't Nicodemus's plan. It wasn't Abraham's plan. Like, okay, God, here's what I'm going to do. I'll sacrifice my son for you. You send your son for us. It was God's plan. And that's the action. For God so loved the world, that he is the one who gave. He gave his son. You see, this is the deal. God's action always reveals God's love. And if God's action reveals God's love, and if you have a relationship with God, then your action should reveal your love for God. Here's the last thing I want you to write down. I want to go ahead and ask the worship team to come on back up. Because here's what I want to leave you with. Jesus did not come so that you'd love him. How many of you guys think that Jesus came that you would love him? All right, I just set you up. How many of you thought, before I said those words, that Jesus came so that you would love him? You see, here's what we're sold on. Here's the good of bills that we're sold in church, is that Jesus came. Here's why Jesus came. Jesus came that you would love him. Like, okay, now Jesus did his part. And so this must mean that now it's my part to do. Like, Jesus came and he died on the cross. Why would I not love him for that? Jesus came so that you would love him. Mm-mm. Jesus didn't come so that you would love him. This wasn't one of those, oh, need things. We get caught in this thing that maybe God needs us. Jesus didn't come so that we would love him. Jesus came so that we would know how much God loves us. That's huge. You think about that. Jesus didn't come so that you would love him. This isn't a pageant contest. This isn't like he got on his best outfit and like he did a song and dance. And everybody goes, oh, Jesus! He does party tricks too. He's really cool. This isn't that. As a matter of fact, that Jesus not only didn't do that, he didn't come so that we would love him. He came for one reason, that God, the God of the universe, the God who created everything, the God who created all that is, and that when we look at the planet and we stand back and go, wow, that's awesome, that's beautiful. We look at the Grand Canyon and go, wow. God says, yeah, I created that. And guess what? I love you. You see, here's the deal breaker, though. Because then we think that, okay, well, in order for me to be a good Christian, then I must do something. And that's what Nicodemus got caught in. That if Jesus came so that we would understand how much God loves us, then now, okay, I get it. Now I've got to do something. I've got to do something to earn God's love. And that's not the deal. It doesn't work that way. And Nicodemus kept trying to earn God's love. He knew all the laws. He knew everything. He knew everything, how everything worked. And he had all 640 of them down. And Jesus was saying, no, you don't get it, Nicodemus. This isn't about that. God just wants you to know you love him. Okay, now in return, here's what happens. At least this is how it happened for me. When I understood that God loved me, even when I wasn't shiny, I knew I didn't have to do anything to prove that I loved him. But I couldn't keep myself from it. I couldn't keep myself from it. It wasn't that I have to do anything. But at some point in my life, I know that I can never repay God. And I know that I'm not really even ever going to try. But I can tell you that because God loves me, God so loves me, in my good days and my bad days, I can't help but love him. This isn't in my notes. But when I was 17 years of age, I got thrown in jail for some stuff. And there's this girl I was dating. She's kind of cute. And I had broken up with her for another girl. Oh, yeah, I was that kind of guy. All the girls are like, you're such a jerk. Yeah, I know. And I'd broken up with her for another girl. And so I'm sitting, and they're booking me. And they have me behind this one-way mirror where I can see out, but you can't see in. It's one of those mirrors. They were taking my picture, my good side and my bad side. And I had these numbers that I was holding. And this girl came walking up, and she was just decked out. She was in this Hawaiian kind of, this red top Hawaiian kind of skirt and red necklace on with red earrings on. I can tell you exactly what she was wearing. And she was bringing me cookies. And she looked and she said, "Hey, is Paul Watson here? I brought him some cookies." And the lady said, "Yeah, Paul Watson's here. And he doesn't get any of those." She, you know, like she was going to slip in a key or something. But here's what happened for me, because I had been treating her bad so I could do what I wanted to do, and yet she loved me. And I can tell you, it was at that moment where I realized her great love for me, that to this day, 23 years later, she can't keep me from loving her. That's how it works. The same works with God. That when you see that God takes you and he goes, "Hey, I love you on your good days and I love you on your bad days." And you realize that God so loved, not the world, replace your name, put your name in there. God so loved Paul Watson that at 17 years of age, shortly after that, I gave my life to Christ because I made the same connection. And 23 years later, he can't keep me from loving him. John 3:16. Let's worship.
Divine romance, lift my heart and my hands to show my love, show my love. Deep, deep flood. An ocean flows from you of deep, deep love. Yeah, it's filling up the room. Your innocent blood has washed my guilty life. In your presence, God, I'm completely satisfied. For you, I'll sing and I'll dance. I'll rejoice in this divine romance. Lift my heart and my hands to show my love. Oh, for you, dance. I rejoice in this divine romance. Lift my heart and my hands to show my love, to show my love.
Sure.
sense. I rejoice in this divine romance. Lift my heart and my hands to show my love. To show my love.
Here's what I want to do. I don't want to do anything special tonight. All right? Sometimes we do an altar call. Sometimes we say, hey, come forward, come pray. I really don't want to do that. I really just want to bow our heads, and I just want to make a connection on this so God thing. So God, for God, so loved the world. For God, so loved me. All right? And here's what I want you to do. I want you to make this connection. Because for me, both connections, when I talk about that connection with my wife, that at that point when I realized that, man, there was nothing I could do that would keep this girl from loving me, which caused me to go, there is nothing that she will ever be able to do to keep me from loving her. And then that same connection came with me in my relationship with God. For God so loved Paul Watson that because of that, it's not that I have to do anything. It's that, man, when you make that connection, you can't help but love him back. And it wasn't an altar call. It wasn't a whatever. It was just a. It was a divine revelation. So right now, God, that the Lord, the day before Thanksgiving, what an incredible night. The day before Thanksgiving, that tonight would be a night that we make a connection that for God so loved us that he sent his only son. And that through that divine revelation, that whoever believes in him, whoever believes in Jesus shall not perish, but would have everlasting life. That God, that tonight would be just a revelation of and not on our good days and not on our bad days. That it's not decided by who we are or how we act. It's not even decided by what we know, God, because I grew up in church. And I so didn't know you. But it was decided because the creator of all the universe was so in love with us that he said, there is nothing you can do that'll keep me from you. And in return tonight, God, that there would be a revelation that we send back to the heavens. Say, God, we so are so thankful. And that, God, there is nothing you can do that will ever keep us from loving you. And that, God, that we want you to know that we love you in return. And that, Father, that some days we show it and some days we don't. But God, that today would be a day that people would reconcile their relationships. And if you're here tonight, then just make that switch in your heart. Make that switch and just ask God's Spirit into your life. And you just say, you know what, God, I want to love you. I want to love you with all that I have and all that I am. And even all that I'm not. It's all yours. Lord, thank you. And so today we give thanks. And Lord, we just ask that you'd be with families tomorrow. And you'd be with people who maybe don't have a family to be with, but they would connect with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Bless you guys. Have a great Thanksgiving, all right?
You too.